Good morning, Depot Church. Let's stand and worship.
Today is fifth Sunday, and here at Depot Church, we set aside every fifth Sunday to pause whatever it is that we're doing, whatever message series that we are in, to participate in the ordinances that Jesus instituted while here on earth. And those are baptism and communion, or the Lord's Supper. We also use fifth Sunday as an opportunity to do parent-child dedications. Now, some fifth Sundays we have baptisms and no parent-child dedications. Some fifth Sundays we have parent-child dedications and no baptisms. Some fifth Sundays we have a little bit of both or several of both. And some fifth Sundays, like today, we have none of either. We do have some that are awaiting a baptism, and we are going to get them scheduled to be baptized soon. But that is okay. We're still going to pause from what we're doing. We're still going to be obedient to God, and we're going to talk about baptism and communion today, and we're going to participate in communion. There could be someone here that has received Jesus as their Savior and has not followed through with being baptized, and so today is a great opportunity for them and for us to talk about baptism. There could be someone here that their next step, they have believed their next step is baptism. And we believe in the formula that is believe and be baptized. That is the formula here at Depot that we believe, and it's the biblical formula of believe. You believe and confess, and you are baptized. All right? But before we get there, I want to do something a little different. Well, hopefully it's not too different. Hopefully it's something we talk about every Sunday, which is the gospel, the good news. But I'm going to be very specific today. I'd like to begin this morning with the gospel, the good news, in a world of bad news. All right? So we're going to look at scripture from Romans. So if you want to open your Bibles to Romans, you can, or your phones or your tablet or whatever it is you read God's Word in. We're going to look at several different chapters and verses, though, and you're going to be familiar with this possibly if you've ever heard the Romans Road of Salvation, right? You ever heard that? The Romans Road to Salvation. Maybe you've heard of it. Maybe you've heard someone read the scripture. Maybe you've used it. It's a old way, but let me. Scripture is not old, by the way. It is just an traditional, maybe that's a better word, way of sharing the good news of Jesus with somebody, the gospel, for them to understand by using scripture. And it is in Romans. And this is what we have to get before there's baptism and communion, right? This is what we have to get, what we have to understand, what we have to know, what we have to believe before we get to the point of baptism and communion. So I pray that it's a great Sunday for your kids to be in here. I pray that everybody is learning and understanding this. So I'm going to just read the scripture from the Romans Road to Salvation. All right, Romans 3:23 is where it starts. All right, for everyone has sinned and fallen short of God's glorious standard. That's Romans 3:23. And then Romans 3:10 through 18. As the scriptures say, and I know we're not in Summer of the Psalms, but when he says, as the scriptures say, in here, there's several psalms going on, okay? No one is righteous, not even one. No one is truly wise. No one is seeking God. All have turned away. All have become useless. No one does good, not a single one. Their talk is foul, like the stench from an open grave. Their tongues are filled with lies. Snake venom drips from their lips. Their mouths are full of cursing and bitterness. They rush to commit murder. Destruction and misery always follows them. They don't know where to find peace. They have no fear of God at all. So everyone has sinned and fallen short of the glorious standard of God. And here is more specifically what is happening in our lives, the sin that is a falling short of the glorious standard. But Romans 6:23, for the wages of sin, these things that were specifically listed and more, for the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus our Lord. All right? Now we jump to Romans 5:8. For the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus our Lord. But God showed his great love for us by sending Christ to die for us while we were still sinners. Everybody with me on the road still? Okay. Romans 10:9. And if you openly declare that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For everyone, and this is, that was Romans 10:9, and we jump to Romans 10:13. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Romans 5:1. Therefore, since we have been made right in God's sight by faith, we have peace with God because of what Jesus Christ our Lord has done for us. And then Romans 8:1. So now there is no condemnation for those who belong to Christ Jesus. And lastly, Romans 8:38 and 39. I appreciate so y'all people. The pages just. Where's he at? I'm a quick talker. I should slow down. I've already been fussed about last word and benediction when I do that. I've already been told, slow down. We're supposed to. And I am convinced that nothing can ever separate us from God's love. Neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither our fears for today or our worries about tomorrow. Not even the powers of hell can separate us from God's love. No power in the sky above or in the earth below. Indeed, nothing in all creation will ever be able to separate us from the love of God that is revealed in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen? And so this is what we believe and what we confess about our God and about our Jesus. And if we do that, then our next step is baptism. We're going to talk about that in a second. But first, I want everybody to bow their heads and close their eyes. And I want us to pray. And if there's someone here that has never received Jesus as their Savior, today, this morning, is your opportunity. And so if you fully believe with your heart and you confess that Jesus is Lord, then I want to give you the opportunity to receive Him today. And here's how we're going to do. I'm not going to make you lift your hand or stand up and come up front. Here's just what I want to do. If you believe what was read from Scripture today, after church, I'm going to be at the back. And I would just love for you to just speak to me. Okay? But we're going to pray. Father God, we thank You for Your Son, Jesus. We thank You for the sacrifice of His life for us, freeing us from sin, giving us eternal life. And so, Father God, I pray if there's someone here who has not received Jesus as their Savior, that they would do so this morning, that they would receive that free gift of eternal life. And God, for all of us, through today, may we remember what it was like when we first made that decision to follow Jesus and when we were first baptized. And the first time we took communion, God, may we remember today. And by remembering, Lord, may that fuel us to continue to walk closer and closer to You. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Amen. So next, believe and be baptized. There's the believe part. Let's talk about baptism. I want you to move to Matthew 3, 13 through 17 if you can. Matthew 3, 13 through 17. And we're going to read about the baptism of Jesus here. Then Jesus went from Galilee to the Jordan River to be baptized by John, but John tried to talk him out of it. "I'm the one who needs to be baptized by you," he said. "So why are you coming to me?" But Jesus said, "It should be done, for we must carry out all that God requires." So John agreed to baptize him. After his baptism, as Jesus came up out of the water, the heavens were opened, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and settling on him. And a voice from the heavens said, "This is my dearly loved Son, who brings me great joy." So the three out of the four synoptic gospels, which is Matthew, Mark, and Luke, all record the baptism of Jesus by John the Baptist, John the Baptizer. I learned this week that the baptism of Jesus, along with the crucifixion, is the starting point for a lot of scholars and historians to study, because they believe without a doubt, historically, certain fact that these two things happened in Jesus' life. He was baptized and he was crucified. And so this becomes these two things become the starting point for their study historically of the person of Jesus. We know that everything in between, right, is historically accurate as well. Listen, we believe that everything in Scripture about Jesus is true. That's what we believe as a church and what we believe as a part of the church, Christianity. And Jesus was baptized by John the Baptist, the baptizer. If Jesus, who we follow, with our lives was baptized, then the question is, shouldn't we be baptized too? Shouldn't we be baptized as well? And there are some things we must all understand about baptism, even if we've already been baptized or even if we're awaiting baptism. Okay? And we're going to talk about just a few things. Number one, baptism does not equal salvation. Okay? Baptism does not equal salvation. We are not saved by our baptism. We are saved by receiving Jesus as our Savior first. Baptism is the follow-through of being saved. Baptism is a symbol of our salvation, and it's an external expression of our inward belief. And baptism, as you know, is symbolic. So we put out this tub of water. It's not magical water, all right? It's water. And we are physically washed of our sins. It's symbolic. We are physically washed of our sins. We are putting to death our old life, and we are raised to new life through Jesus Christ. It's symbolism. Water, we will never thirst again because of our salvation and our baptism through Jesus. That's why we baptize. It is a symbolic expression of what we believe. It's a declaration of our dependence on God. It is our time to say, look, I believe, and now I'm going to follow through and follow with my life Jesus. The other important thing I want to note is that we must remember our baptism. We must remember our baptism. I told y'all before, like, I was, I think, 4 to 5 range when I was baptized as a kid. That's kind of young. But now I'm a preacher, so it kind of proves maybe that, I don't know, no, it doesn't. It doesn't do anything. A lot happened between 5 years old and preaching. but that's kind of young, 4 and 5, right? But I believed this. I believed in my heart this, and I was ready, and I confessed with my mouth that Jesus is Lord, and I believed it in my heart, and so those are the two things. If you're wondering about your kid, those are the two things. Do you love Jesus with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and you don't want to move forward from this point loving others the way that you are loved? That's what you talk to your kids about. And if they can understand that, and they can understand what Jesus has done for them, then they are ready. But I was young, and I honestly, outside of running into the VHS every now and then, the VHS recording of me being baptized at that age, I don't remember the actual, like, going into the water and coming out. And that's why when we're here and we baptize, I always take a moment and I talk to whoever we're baptizing, and I say, hey, remember this, or I'll talk to them a little bit how proud I am of them and what God is going to do in their lives and all that kind of stuff. But I want them to just slow down for a moment, just like at weddings. You ever been to a wedding? I did. I make the bride and groom, I say, stop, look at everybody that is here to celebrate with you. You know, take a minute, soak it in, because I want them to remember. I want to remember how the water felt, right? If it was cold or if it was hot. I remember if I accidentally choked them, right, as they went down. I want them to remember their baptism, because it is a pivotal point in the life of a Christian. And so I want them to remember their baptism. And so I don't remember my actual underneath coming up part of the baptism, but here's what I remember. I've told you all this before. I remember the pastor who has passed away now, coming to the house, right, and I and hearing the footsteps. I was so excited. I was sitting on the floor, hearing the footsteps coming around the porch, right, and I knew he was coming to talk to me about Jesus and about being baptized. And I remember hearing him come around the porch and coming inside. I remember the chair he sat in. I remember me on the ground. I remember him talking to me about it, about Jesus and about baptism and everything. And I remember, like, yeah, Let's do this, right? Let's do this. I do remember that part. And when I think about baptism, that's where my mind goes, to that pastor coming to my house, because that's pretty cool when the pastor comes to your house. And so it's important that we remember our baptism. I'm not going to do the direct quote today, but Martin Luther said, anytime you are splashed with water or swimming in a pool or taking a bath or washing your face or washing your hands or drinking some water, anytime you connect with water in some way, remember your baptism. And so that's what I want all of us to do, is to remember our baptism. And when our kids and when people are baptized here, I want us to help them remember their baptism. All right? We're going to move into our time of communion. Did everybody get theirs? There may be some more back on the table. You can run back and get it. Just hang on to it. So we're talking about the two ordinances, baptism and communion. Baptism at the beginning of Jesus' ministry, and he institutes that ordinance, and towards the end of his life and ministry, he institutes the ordinance of communion or the Lord's Supper. Make sure everybody's got their elements. So he and his disciples, they were in Jerusalem for Passover, and they were in the upper room together, and they were there for the Passover meal. And then I'm going to jump to Scripture now, and it's Matthew 26, 17 through 30. And I want you to hold on to this. You can open it if you want to, but just hold on. We're going to get there. I don't want you to do it while we read the Scripture. We'll come back to it. On the first day of the festival of unleavened bread, the disciples came to Jesus and asked, "Where do you want us to prepare the Passover meal for you?" "As you go into the city," he told them, "you will see a certain man. Tell him, 'The teacher says, my time has come, and I will eat the Passover meal with my disciples at your house.'" So the disciples did as Jesus told them and prepared the Passover meal there. When it was evening, Jesus sat down at the table with the 12. And while they were eating, he said, "I tell you the truth, one of you will betray me." And greatly distressed, each one asked in turn, "Am I the one, Lord?" And he replied, "One of you who has just eaten from this bowl with me will betray me. For the Son of Man must die, as the Scriptures declared long ago, but how terrible it would be for the one who betrays him. It would be far better for that man if he had never been born." Judas, the one who would betray him, also asked, "Rabbi, am I the one?" And Jesus told him, "You have said it." And as they were eating, Jesus took some bread. Don't do it yet. We're going to do it here in just a little bit. We'll talk first. Jesus took some bread, blessed it, then he broke it in pieces, and he gave it to the disciples, saying, "Take this and eat, for this is my body." And he took a cup of wine and gave thanks to God for it. He gave it to them and said, "Each of you drink from it, for this is my blood, which confirms the covenant between God and his people. It is poured out as a sacrifice to forgive the sins of many. Mark my words, I will not drink wine again until the day I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom." Then they sang a hymn and went out to the Mount of Olives. When I read this time for this fifth Sunday, when I read this, something stuck out to me about Judas this time. The betrayal of Jesus by Judas. It actually happened kind of prior to this Last Supper moment. He'd already struck a deal with the religious leaders. Jesus for 30 pieces of silver. And I've read differing opinions about what exactly that amount would be, what the value of the 30 pieces of silver would have been in those days. Some say not a whole lot. Others say 3 to 4 months' wages. Well, I guess depends on what you're doing in those days, whether or not that's a lot of money. And for a disciple who's following Jesus and counting on people to take care of him, maybe that was a good bit of money to him. In the Gospel of Luke's account, it says that Satan entered Judas. It doesn't say that in the others, but it says it in the Gospel of Luke's account. Greed entered Judas. Greed does not care about the value of something. It just cares about having it. In fact, the definition of greed is a strong desire for possessions, especially for possessions belonging to another. Judas was filled with greed. The enemy doesn't care about your value. He just wants you. Not because he really wants you. He just doesn't want Jesus to have you. Greed. We get actually the phrase selling out or a sellout. We get that phrase from Judas's actions towards Jesus. In all three of these synoptic gospel accounts that I read, it doesn't say that Judas didn't receive the Lord's Supper. In a lot of accounts, it shows him get up and leaving, like if you watch a movie or something, right? But y'all can prove me wrong, that's fine. But what I read, it never says Judas left. Judas got up and left. It kind of suggests that actually Judas was still there and a part of everything that was going on with the Last Supper. The enemy in him, the greed in him, is still there at the table, although it's not a table like we think of it to be I don't want to mess up again. Leonardo da Vinci, right? It's not like that. They're lounging. Meals then were they took their time. It was a lot of storytelling, okay? And so it doesn't tell us that he left. It's possible that he could have still been there and greed as well. We also know, though, at that same table is Peter. And Peter will deny Jesus three times within the next 24 hours. So greed is at the table, and then denial is at the table with Jesus receiving communion. We also know that the disciples will fall asleep. Jesus says, don't fall asleep, hang out, wait. Twice in Matthew, told them to keep watch. They fall asleep. So sloth is at the table receiving communion. It's a lack of effort. Sloth is a lack of effort in the face of a necessary task. That's the definition. Causing it to go undone. So sloth is at the table. And then you think about this. This changes the way we look at Psalm 23:5, which we talked about from last week. You prepare a feast for me in the presence of my enemies. Listen, Jesus shared a meal with people he loved, but also the sin that he hates. Jesus went to the cross for the people he loves to vanquish the sin he hates. And he asked those sinful people at the table to remember him, not their sins. And so today we remember Jesus, not our sins. Today we focus on Jesus and not sin. But listen, today, if there is a sin that you need to confess, in fact, Scripture tells us don't take Holy Communion. If there is unforgiveness in your heart, leave, go forgive somebody, forgive them, come back. If there is sin that you need to confess, if there is a sin you need forgiveness for or you need to forgive someone else, before we do this thing, talk to Jesus about it. Pray before we receive communion. Because we got to make way in our minds and hearts to remember Jesus and not our sins. That's what this is about. Remembering Jesus, focusing upon Jesus, and not at our sins. So, if you would, we're going to pray, give you an opportunity to talk to Jesus, and then we'll receive communion. Father God, We pray for forgiveness of our sins and our failures. Where we have fallen short. We thank you for Jesus. That though we continue to fall short, through his sacrifice, we are loved. God, will you help us as from this day forward to run from sin, to seek righteousness. And Lord, if there's forgiveness that we seek from you, Lord, I pray that we would cry out to you and confess our wrongdoings right now. And that we would receive forgiveness. And Father God, if there's someone in our lives that we need to forgive, or we need forgiveness from, God, I pray that we would seek that. Father God, so our heart space and our mind space would not be focused on sin, but focused on the Savior. In Jesus' name we pray. Everybody say, amen. Amen. So we'll go back. As he was at the table, Jesus took some bread. And he blessed it. And then he broke it into pieces. And he gave it to his disciples. And he said, take and eat, for this is my body. And he took some wine and he gave thanks to God for it. And he gave it to them and he said, each of you drink from it, for this is my blood which confirms the covenant between God and his people. It is poured out as a sacrifice to forgive the sin of many. Mark my words, I will not drink wine again until the day I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom. Bow in prayer. Father God, as we have read Scripture and as we have taken and received communion, I pray that we remember our baptism, but we also remember the sacrifice of your Son Jesus for us. And God, may we not leave this place without having a relationship with you through your Son Jesus. And may we not leave this place without having you as Lord of our life. And so God, as we stand and we sing, the opportunity for that is here. But also the opportunity to pray for loved ones and pray for each other. So God, I pray that your Holy Spirit would move in us as we stand and sing in a moment. Lord, thank you for these ordinances that we participate in today. We love you and we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.